For the scripture reading this morning, we'll be reading from 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 11 to chapter 7, verse 3. Let's respond to our Lord in conviction as we read His words. We have spoken freely to you, Corinthians, and opened wide our hearts to you. We are not withholding our affections from you, but you are withholding yours from us. As a fair exchange, I speak as to my children. Open wide your hearts also.
Do not be yoked together with unbelievers. For what do righteousness and wickedness have in common? Or what fellowship can light have with darkness? What harmony is there between Christ and Belial? Or what does a believer have in common with an unbeliever?
What agreement is there between the temple of God and idols? For we are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will live with them and walk among them, and I'll be their God, and they will be my people.
Therefore, come out from them and be separate, says the Lord. Touch no unclean thing, and I will receive you. And I will be a father to you, and you will be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty.
Therefore, since we have these promises, dear friends, let us purify ourselves from everything that contaminates body and spirit, perfecting holiness out of reverence for God. Together,
make room for us in your hearts.
We have wronged no one. We have corrupted no one. We have exploited no one. I do not say this to condemn you. I said before that you have such a place in our hearts that we will live or die with you. Thank you for reading the words of God. The Lord's messenger this morning is Pastor Dave. Bring us a message. Make space in your hearts.
Good morning. It's really good to see all of you here. And good morning to the children too. Glad you're here. Hi, children. Oi. Hello. Thank you. Well, it'd be really good if you guys could all keep your Bibles opened or switched on to 2 Corinthians as we go through the last bit of chapter 6 into chapter 7. Before I begin, let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we ask that through your word and by the power of your Holy Spirit, you show us our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, in the month of June, we're doing this series on gospel culture. How does the gospel change the way we relate with God and with each other, right? How does the gospel change the way we relate with God and one another? Last week, you heard from Pastor Wei-En how the gospel makes us vulnerable. It makes us more willing to be exposed, to be wounded, even to be hurt for the sake of another. And this week, we're going to explore how the gospel makes us hospitable. Hospitable. Being hospitable means being willing to receive. To receive other people into our place, even into our lives. Some describe hospitality as being willing to make space for another, to make space for another. I've already explored in earlier sermons, firstly from Luke, on how the gospel can make space in our church. It makes us more willing to receive and to minister to different demographics from what we're comfortable with. And in another sermon from the book of Hebrews on how the gospel can make space in our homes. It makes us more risk-taking so that we would even consider inviting a stranger into our house. But today I thought I'd explore the book of 2 Corinthians on how the gospel can make space in our hearts, how the gospel can make space in our hearts. I mean, look at the language Paul uses. We have spoken freely to you, Corinthians. We have opened wide our hearts to you. We're not withholding any affection from you. I have said before that you have such a place in our hearts that we would live with you or even die with you. Isn't that amazing? More than in any other letter, here Paul describes the kind of love he has for the believers. He has such a deep and genuine love for them. It's an unrestrained love. Did you see that? We don't withhold any affection. There's nothing superficial or temporary or transactional about Paul's love. He holds nothing back. Human limitations aside, whatever Paul can give to strengthen this relationship, he will give. We see him give his time, his energy, his prayers, his physical strength. I read this letter and see how much Paul has given of himself to them. My heart is wide open to you. It's an unconditional kind of love. And more than that, when Paul loves the believers, they take up residence in his heart. Did you see that? You have place in our hearts, he says. It's permanent residence. So that we would live with you, even die with you. That's the kind of description of love you'd expect in marriage, right? It's the kind of love you'd expect in parenting. Another person has now entered into your life, and you're going to make space for them. Meaning that from now on, you're going to commit yourselves to them. You're never going to let them go. Even when you're apart, this person still resides in your heart. You think about them, you care for them, you're praying for them. You're so concerned how they're doing for their growth and well-being. That's what it means when you have made space for someone in your heart. It means they now take up permanent residence there. They forever are part of your life. That's what it means to make space in your heart. Someone enters and takes up permanent residence. They're forever part of your life. You're never going to let them go. In fact, you would live with them, you would die with them. They are that precious to you. And it's not just Paul who loves his fellow believers in such an unrestrained way. It's Timothy too. Did you see that? We have opened wide our hearts to you. You have a place in our hearts. Even introverted, mild-mannered, timid Timothy is capable of this kind of love. See, because making space, it was never about personality or gifting. It's about the gospel. The reason that Paul and Timothy, and later we see Titus, can love with this kind of depth, sincerity, can love so many people, I mean dozens of believers, right, with such giant heart capacity. How big are their hearts? It is because the gospel has changed them. It was the love of God shown in Christ Jesus to them that made their hearts have so much space. The gospel, the love of God shown in Christ Jesus to them has made their heart have so much space for so many others. Friends, I strongly believe that when we are filled with the love of God, one effect is that our hearts grow bigger. We become people who love a bit more freely. We love a bit more deeply. We genuinely have concern for many. I mean, that's my own story, kind of. I see myself a bit more like Timothy. Mild, introverted, initially not very keen on social interactions, certainly don't like a lot of people. And yet now, 15 and 20 years later, I look at my calendar, it's ridiculous. How many meetups daily? And how regularly? for years. How many relationships have I built up? How many friendships with many of you? You've become precious to me. So many. I'm always amazed at how many people seem to fit or reside in my heart. I think about you. I pray for you. I'm always wondering how you're doing. I didn't have that kind of heart before that so many people lived inside. I didn't have that heart before. Or even that kind of inclination or personality or I dare say gifting. But I believe it's God who's grown my heart. And I've seen that with many of our other fellow leaders too. People initially, you look at them, okay, they're not so outgoing, not so willing to spend time in terms of sharing lives with others. But as they step up and they serve God and they let the love of God, the gospel, transform them, it expands their heart. And now look at them years later. I think that's the real benefit of stepping up to become a leader in God's church. God's going to blow up your heart. And you're going to be amazed at what He can do with it. I think that's how eternity will be like, when we have fully redeemed hearts. They're going to be so big that we're genuinely going to be able to love millions, if not billions of people, brothers and sisters, with absolute sincerity and care. I mean, that's the kind of heart God wants to give us right now and more so then. His own heart, so big a heart. And I'm beginning to look forward to that. Yes, initially introverted loves to spend time by himself in an empty room. Dave is now looking forward to that time where I have the space, the capacity to be in the presence of millions. It is the gospel that expands our hearts. It's the gospel that makes you want to have space. Unfortunately, the Corinthians did not have such hearts. Let's look again at what Paul said. We have spoken freely to you, Corinthians. We opened wide our hearts to you. We never held any affection from you, but you. You're withholding your affection from us. And so in return, as a fair exchange, and I'm speaking as if to my children, open wide your hearts also. We've made place for you in our hearts. Make room in your hearts for us. Open wide your hearts also. Make room in your hearts for us. If you read through this letter, you will quickly notice that despite the fact that Paul sincerely and consistently, persistently loved the Corinthian believers deep, deep, they did not reciprocate. In fact, it seemed the believers were becoming increasingly suspicious of the Apostle Paul and his team. Somehow they were no longer able to recognize Paul's God-given love to them. Becoming increasingly suspicious. Paul had to write this letter, in fact, to justify himself, to prove to them that he loves them. I really love you. He says how many times in this letter? I really love you. God knows I love you. I do, really, I do. You're in my heart. But how come I'm no longer in yours? You're in my heart, but how come I'm no longer in yours? And something had happened with these believers such that they were no longer able to recognize or receive or reciprocate Paul's love. Something had happened with these believers such that they were no longer able to recognize or receive or reciprocate Paul's love, perhaps even the love of God. Their hearts had changed. They had become small and constricted. No love, no space. What was going on? Well, Paul continued. Do not be yoked together with unbelievers. For what do righteousness and wickedness have in common? Or what fellowship can light have with darkness? What harmony is there between Christ and Belial? What does a believer have in common with an unbeliever? What agreement is there between the temple of God and idols? The problem seemed to be that they were yoking themselves with unbelievers. To be yoked is to be tied together with someone such that you have to move in the same direction. Other words he uses are partnership, fellowship, agreement, harmony, union, all describing this very close relationship with another in such a way that this other person now changes your direction, significantly influences your life trajectory. Let me say that again. To be yoked together means to have some form of very close relationship, in this case, with an unbeliever, that they now become a key influence in your life. He or she now impacts your choices, changes your priorities, affects your decisions, affects your heart. And now you start moving in a different direction. He or she impacts your choices, changes your priorities, affects your decisions, and affects your heart. And now you start moving in a different direction. Friends, the minute we come to Christ, we changed our life direction, right? That's what the word repentance means. It means once you were walking this way, but now thanks to the gospel, Christ saved you. You changed life direction. You now follow Christ. But a non-believer, well, the Bible says many times they follow the devil. They pursue the cravings of the flesh, as we once did. They still walk in darkness. Their life goals are still idols. Wealth and power, sex and status, security, comfort, lifestyle, luxury, they pursue idols. And so the life direction of an unbeliever is completely antagonistic to those who now follow Christ. And so Paul says, don't yoke yourselves to them. Form this kind of very close partnership with an unbeliever such that they are affecting your heart and changing back your life direction. It's going to take you away from Christ. It's going to take you away from the love of God. It's going to take you away from Christ. It seems the reason the Corinthian believers had now become suspicious of Paul, they were no longer able to recognize or receive or reciprocate the love of Paul, even the love of God, was because they had formed new, tight, yoked partnerships with unbelievers. Their hearts were changed, stolen, now getting filled up with idols, with other worldly things. And so Paul is appealing to them, widen your heart, make space in your hearts. Look at what they're filled up with, make space in your hearts. Basically, you got to make some evictions. You may have to end certain relationships. Because these partnerships are taking you away from Christ. You may have to end certain relationships because they're taking you away from Christ. But what does that mean, right? What kind of partnerships is Paul talking about? Is this about romantic relationships? Yes, I would say so. If you date or marry someone who's not interested in the gospel, clearly that is an unequal yoke. Confirm they will pull you in a different direction. I mean, some of you know my story, right? It's about 25 years ago now. I had a serious relationship with a non-Christian girl. And that was one of the primary reasons I left church. The closer I got to her, the more my priorities changed. I found myself thinking very differently about God, faith, and life. All those doctrines that had been drilled to me over two decades suddenly felt off, didn't make a lot of sense. See, the heart is a very powerful thing, my friends. Once it gets attached to something or someone, our entire value system can change, often overnight. We like to think we're people of the head. We're not. We're people of the heart. What the heart attaches to will affect your overall life directions. And while there are some miracles where the spouse converts and becomes a sincere believer, praise God, yes. But there are many more stories you never hear. Why? Because they've left church, they've left the faith. More often than not, we're far more impacted by an unbeliever than them by us. Because we're much more familiar with that world. The closer we get, the more strange, foreign, distant becomes the gospel. We're no longer able to recognize, receive, or reciprocate the love of God in the gospel because this person now has our heart. It is changed. Which is why our church policy, and I'm pretty sure most churches' policy, is not to marry a Christian with a non-Christian. We know how dangerous that is to your faith. It is one of the leading causes all throughout the Old Testament, one of the leading causes why people walk away. And so, my friends, are there certain romantic relationships that you have to reconsider? Are they impacting your heart, taking you away from Christ? Do not yoke yourself with an unbeliever. What kind of partnerships is Paul talking about? Is this about friendships? Yes, I would say so. Because obviously close friendships affect us. They affect our hearts. And this could be for good or not so good. Some relationships, friendships, pull us away from Christ. We see this particularly in teenagers and younger adults. A lot of choices they make in life is not because they've rationally thought through the pros and cons, it's because of peer influence. I don't go to church because my friend don't go to church. Really, the logic is that simple. That's how the heart works. It's one of the main reasons why youth walk away. Which is why, as a parent, I'm so concerned. I take pains that my children, especially my youth, have the settings where they can hopefully meet and be friends with some other Christians. Because I know from experience, all it takes is to have just one or two believing friends. And that makes all the difference. Because when I left church, it was those one or two believing friends. One of them is Pastor Tsuwen, by the way. That made all the difference. And these days, it's not just physical friendships. It's virtual friendships that pull us in all kinds of directions, right? Because for a lot of the new generation, the virtual friendship is more real than the real friendship. The social media friendship is what pulls the heart. And it's not just about the young. Me too, right? The more I follow certain accounts, the more I feel my heart pulled. Which is why I often find myself reinstalling and deleting Instagram and forget about more pervasive social media like TikTok. You know, like, cannot lah! It's got my heart so fast, right? Either by the sexualized content or the lifestyle content or the perpetual obsession with food. The more I follow certain accounts, well, very fast, eh? My heart is so far there. The gospel not important. The love of others not important. The kingdom not important. The food more important. It filled my heart. So fast. 2 hours of scrolling. Not every friendship, relationship, physical or virtual, is healthy for our hearts. we may have to be discerning enough to end certain partnerships. Do not yoke yourselves with unbelievers. What kind of partnerships is Paul talking about? Is this about business partnerships, career choices? Yes, I would say so. Now, I don't mean we just join Christian organizations. Some of them are equally dodgy. No, what I mean is in our career, we spend so much time with individuals or companies whose culture may be very influential, very powerful in what they're pursuing. We had a session in youth fellowship a few months ago, and some young adults were sharing how hard it is to be in an MNC with an overwhelming culture. Some can tahan, resist, and even be a witness. Yes, praise God. But if we're honest, most cannot. They find themselves getting sucked in, wanting to pursue what everyone else is pursuing. And eventually that normalizes, and we believe pursuing those things is more valuable than Christ. You know, these days when people tell me with big smiles that they've secured their dream degree or their dream job, I want to be happy for them. I do, and I am. But I also kind of cringe because I know how hard that's going to be on you spiritually. Those idols will grip you. In a few years, you may find yourself very far from Christ. Friends, discern again. If you're unable to be distinct in your company, to be salt and light in that place, you may have to consider resigning. Don't let it steal your heart. End that partnership. Do not be yoked with unbelievers. So I do believe Paul's instructions to end unbelieving partnership can be applied across the board in all dimensions of relationship, dating or business or social media or friendships. But I also think there is one situation that Paul is most concerned about: the Corinthians' relationship with certain spiritual leaders. The Corinthian church's partnership with certain spiritual leaders. See, if we read to the end of the letter, we see that some influential teachers had come in. They called themselves super apostles. Not just apostle, like Paul, but super apostle. These were religious celebrities with an impressive CV, qualified, educated, notable pedigree, probably good looking too. Fantastic preachers who could command a huge audience, who could demand an even bigger salary. And they loved to boast about themselves, their achievements and conquests. They were everything the world desires in a leader. Super apostles, they called themselves. Super apostles who, yes, surprisingly, preach even Jesus Christ. The content of their preaching was Jesus Christ. And yet, Paul says these are not super apostles. These are false apostles. They're not even Christian. What they are advertising is not the gospel. It is the world, the flesh, idols. Can you not see that the content of their preaching is to pursue wealth and power, sex and status, comfort and security, lifestyle and luxury? They're pursuing those things wrapped up in Christian jargon. Just labeled Jesus, but they're nothing to do with Jesus. Paul says, that's a different gospel, that's a different Jesus, can't you see? That looks nothing like Christ. Of all the unbelieving partnerships, this is the most dangerous. Because in the other scenarios, business, friendship, romantic relationship, at least you know in your head that person's not a Christian. You know. You know what you may be getting yourself into. But in this case, these leaders claim to be Christian, Christian authorities. And they talk about Jesus all the time. Yet look at their character, look at their ministry, nothing like Christ. they're going to take you away from Christ. Unfortunately, in Singapore, there seem to be more and more similar Christian leaders. Very impressive according to the flesh, but they won't look anything like the weakness of the Apostle Paul. They won't look anything like the crucified Christ, the Lamb who was slain for us. Friends, a little advice. If a church leader, no matter what they're preaching, no matter how popular they are, no matter how good they sound, no matter their gifting, if their life and ministry is not characterized by weakness, humility, sincerity, simplicity, hardship, affliction, suffering, if their life and ministry is not characterized by weakness, humility, sincerity, simplicity, affliction, hardship, suffering, then maybe you want to be a bit more discerning. Stop following these guys, Paul says. Certainly do not partner with them. Stop going to their churches, listening to their sermons, their podcasts, their YouTube videos. Stop getting deceived, he says. They're not followers of Christ. I quote him. He says, servants of Satan. Can't you see how much I love you? Can't you see how jealous I am for you? Can't you see how jealous God is for you? Don't you understand why God kept saying he's so jealous for you? This is not about my ego. It's about your heart. Your heart is being stolen away, clogged up with idols, taken from Christ. Don't voluntarily partner yourselves with unbelievers. Your heart will be taken from Christ. Friends, I know these instructions to terminate partnerships can sound really harsh. When I first heard them growing up, I did not take them very well. But I hope you can see why Paul is saying this. It's not because God wants us to be exclusive or separatist. It's not because God doesn't love or want to save our unbelieving friends. Of course he does more than you. He loves them more than you. The gospel is meant to change us into people like Paul. People with huge hearts who can love so many, so deeply. But this kind of yoked relationship with unbelievers will only shrink your heart, will only take you further away from Christ. It will change your thinking, change your direction, change your priorities. It will make you less able to receive or recognize or reciprocate the love of God. And if you are no longer filled with the love of God, then what will happen to you? And what will happen to your unbelieving friends and family? This is not the way. Paul ends with a quotation. It's an amalgamation of three Old Testament passages. For we are the temple of the living God. And as God said, I will live with them, and I will walk among them, and I will be their God, and they will be my people. Therefore, come out from them, be separate from them, says the Lord. Touch no unclean thing, and I will receive you. I will be a father to you. You will be my sons and daughters, says the Lord God Almighty. All throughout the Old Testament, God made this promise. If we come out from them, if we separate ourselves from the world, literally, if we terminate our partnerships with those who influence us to pursue the world, the flesh, chase after Babylon, then God will welcome us. The promise is God will welcome us, receive us, be with us, be a father to us. We will know the promise and presence. We will experience the promises and presence of the love of God. You know, I think of it a bit like the prodigal son story. All throughout the story, the father loved the son in an unrestrained way, in with unconditional love. The son always had a place in the father's heart. Yet, the son could not recognize the father's love, did not know how to receive it, certainly did not reciprocate. Why? Because his heart was filled up, entangled, and snared by so many worldly things. And only when those worldly things failed, only when he severed ties with those who pursued the flesh, then the Father's love came rushing back in. Arms wide open, welcomed in. The love was always there, love was always there. See, that's what it means when God makes space in his heart for you. It means you're always in his heart, you're always on his mind. Friends, once we are saved by the gospel, God makes a covenant. You are permanently in his heart, and he's never going to let you go. He's utterly committed to you. His love is always there, always, always, always. But often we don't experience it because our heart is pursuing, attached to, congested with so many other things. So let me ask you, brothers and sisters, do you know and experience the love of God? Perhaps in this season you cannot. Your heart feels nothing. It is numb and it feels nothing. God's love is a nice idea, but the experience of it, nothing. Perhaps you once had it before when you first believed, but now, nothing. Could it be because your heart is now filled with other things? Being stolen away through other people, other relationships. Attached to things that pull you away from Christ. So maybe now is a good time to reflect and review. Review particularly certain relationships. Which ones are drawing you near to God? And which ones, if we're honest, are pulling you away from Christ? Do you have to end those partnerships? Do not be yoked with unbelievers. If you need to talk to someone, the pastors and elders are here. We are genuinely concerned with your well-being, your spiritual well-being. We love you. Because friends, let me again reassure you that once you believe in Christ, God straight away brings you into his heart. He's got this huge heart with so much space, enough, more than enough for each and every one of you. And once you're in, you're there. He's never going to let you go. He promises to love you with the deepest and sincerest love, with an unconditional, unrestrained affections, which we see fully in the cross of Christ. He has made so much space for you. So would you make some space for him? Would you make some space for him? Shall we pause for a moment of silence as we reflect on his word? Father, we confess we really don't understand your love. Help us. Amen.